Cornerstone Church. If this is your first time here with us, here's some things you should know.
We're so excited that you're here. At the info booth in the foyer, we have a gift just for you. No strings attached.
Today's service is going to be about an hour and 15 minutes long, and at the end of service, everyone's going to get a chance to commit their lives to Christ.
Hey, if you have kids from ages babies to sixth graders, bring them back to our safe and fun environment where they can worship and learn about God.
If you want to get connected to community, our Next Steps class is the first Sunday of every month.
To find your people, you can go to cornerstone.org, or you can download our app to find a group that interests you.
While the app is downloading, we would ask that you put your phones on the silent mode so we don't distract anyone from the service today.
Here at Cornerstone, we gather for God's attendance, for His glory, and to praise His holy name.
Good morning, Cornerstone Church. Go ahead and stand with us as we get ready to worship.
Your word is a lamp unto my feet. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on it. It's a narrow road, the mercy's wide, cause you're good on your promise. I'll take you at your word. If you said it, I'd believe it. I've seen how good it works. If you start it, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. You spoke, and the chaos fell in line. No, cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road
that leads to life,
but I don't wanna be on it. It's a narrow road,
the tide is high,
cause you're part of the waters. I'll take you at your word. If you said it, I I've seen
how good it was.
If you start it, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. If you said it, I believe it. I take you at
your word.
If you start it, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. That your love would never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. No, you said I'm saved. You called me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You never fail, so I know that you'll never fail me. You said our love would never give up. You said your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. No. You said I'm saved. You call me yours. You said my future's full of your hope. You never fail. So I know, come on church, sing it. I'll take you at your word. If you said it, I believe it. I've seen
how good it was.
I've
seen it in my life, and I know that you've seen it in yours.
I'll take you at your word. If you said it, I've seen how good it works. If you start it, you'll complete it. I'll take you at your word. Oh yeah. Good on your promise. Oh good. He's so good. I'll take you at your word.
A shout of praise. Before we go on, I just want to remind you guys, during the second song, we're going to have our prayer team back here in the back. And I want to challenge you, put your faith to action today. If you have something going on in your life and you need to partner with somebody, go back there, grab one of them, share what's going on in your life, ask them to pray with you and partner with you. Trust that God is going to do what he says he's going to do in your life. And let's worship Jesus.
Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. And I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. So I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength. 'Cause I built my life on Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful in every season. So why would he fail now? Called to be spectators of worship. That's not our job. Our job, the reason for our breath is to worship God, right? And so this next moment, I'm going to challenge you to step out of your comfort zone and sing out with me. Rain came and went. Come on. But my house was built on you. Come on, sing it out. And I'm safe with you, and I'm gonna make it through. Sing it out. Rain came and went, blew, but my house was built on you. It's on you. And I'm safe with you, and I'm gonna make it through. It's on you. I'm standing strong on you. I'm gonna make it through. Lord, my house is built on you. Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand when everything around me shakes. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. 'Cause he's never let me down. He's faithful in generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. He won't. Pressure off of us. So declare this with me. Every voice, every tongue. Rain came and went, blew, but my house was built on you. So I'm safe. Church. Rain came and went, blew, but my house was built on you. Declare it, and I'm safe with you, and I'm gonna make it through. Rain came, rain came, rain came and went, blew, but my house was built on you. Every voice. Christ is my firm foundation. Sing it out. The rock on which I stand when everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail now? He won't. for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will see of the goodness.
God, we just thank you for today. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for the goodness of God. God, I just lift today up to you. I lift everybody in this room up to you, God. And I just say, have your way, God. Have your way. Do in us what only you can do, God. We just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Take a few seconds and greet somebody around you. Good morning. Thank you. Thank you, Johnny. Let's try it again. Good morning. All right, listen, there's grace. I get it. Everybody's going back to their seats, sitting down, and you can't sit down and talk at the same time. I get it. I get it. I can't pat my head and rub my stomach at the same time either. It's just genetic flaws, right? Hey, we're doing things a little bit different. So we're going to do announcements at the front for this series. It's going to be really good, and we're doing it for you. We're doing it so that we can go back into worship at the end. We're excited about it. It's going to be a good time. So, yeah, you can clap for that. That's fine. 17 of you that clapped, I appreciate it. It keeps me going. Hey, real quick, if you're new here with us, let me say thank you for coming. And there's a card in the seat back in front of you. You can fill that out and actually take it over to the information desk, and they've got a little something for you. We want you to come back for three more times, though. We call it See for Three. Come back and see what God wants to do in and through your lives when you partner with us. Wednesday night. How many of you guys showed up to Wednesday nights last week? All right. Quite a few more. Quite a few more. Well, hey, if you didn't show up, you missed out, because Wednesday nights is all about going deeper with God, going deeper in the Word of God, and just seeing what it means and what it means for us, and getting a better understanding of how it relates to us today. So don't miss it. Please come to it. We open the doors at 6. There's finger foods. You guys can hang out and talk and just chill. And then it starts at 7, runs to about 8:30. It was great last week. I think we had 150 people in this room alone, and a bunch of kids and a bunch more youth. So come to it if you're not coming to it. Next weekend is baptisms. And I know we already did baptisms once, but we love baptisms so much that we're going to do it again. We're going to do it again. So if you were on the fence and you didn't jump in with that, hey, you got another opportunity. You got another opportunity. Get registered for that, and let's get you baptized. So this week, today, actually, Pastor Jason is at another church, and he's going to have some exciting news for you when he gets back. But I just want to say, your generosity, we are making a difference across Southwest Kansas and in this region. And that is because of you guys. Whether it's here in Plains, we're going to launch in Dodge soon, and we've got a lot of stuff going on. I just want to say thank you for your generosity. There's three ways to give. They're on the screen behind me, but we could not do those things without you. So thank you very much. And if you guys put your hands together, let's welcome Pastor Christy. She's going to give us a word today.
Well, good morning. It's so good to see all of you and to be here. I am really excited about the message today. I'm really excited about this new series, Identity Shift. And so it's my privilege to get to start this out. And so we are going to be focusing this first message on identity, about our identity as a child of God and what that actually means for us. So before we jump in, let's just pray really quick. Father God, thank you for today. Thank you for the beautiful sunshine and for everyone who's here today, God. I just pray, Lord, that we know your Holy Spirit is here, and I ask that you would just open our hearts, open our minds to what you have for each of us today, God. I thank you and praise you and give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we jump into this series on identity, I felt like it would be really important for us to kind of just get our minds wrapped around what identity is and kind of get us a definition of identity. And so for me, sometimes the best way to identify what something is to kind of rule out what it is not. So we're going to start out with just kind of talking about a few things that, honestly, in our culture, you don't have to look around very hard to see that there's a lot of confusion about identity, and people are desperately seeking identity and trying to find it any way that they possibly can. So we're just going to touch on a couple things that can get confusing for us sometimes. And sometimes we try to get our identity from different things. So one thing that we a lot of times just may find ourselves doing is identifying with our role in life. With maybe you're a mom, maybe you're a dad, maybe you're a student, an athlete. Whatever your role is in life, that is your role in life. But it changes and it shifts as you go through life. And so that is not actually our identity. Our identity goes way deeper than that, and it also doesn't change. Another thing that we sometimes fall into, it's super easy to fall into this trap of what other people think of us. And so sometimes we can try to find our identity and base it on what other people think of us. And so that makes us be kind of like perfectionistic or performance-minded, and that's not identity. That's not identity at all. That's not, that's trying to people please. That's trying to be something that we're not, and that's not what God intended for us in our identity. Sometimes it's easy to get confused with our feelings being our identity. Sometimes you hear people say, and maybe we've said it, I am anxious, or I am depressed. Those are things that that happen, but those are not our identity. And if we're not careful, we can let them become our identity. And then everything in our world is just shaped around that feeling. Another thing that's easy to get confused with our identity is our job or our career. Again, these things can change, and they're going to shift and flow throughout our lives. And our identity doesn't change. Who God created us to be doesn't change. And I know it's easy to do, because what's the first thing you ask someone when you are introduced to a new person? Usually it's like, so what do you do? Well, what do you do? Oh, well, I am a teacher, or I am a lawyer, or I am a pastor, you know. And it's hard for me and anyone else who's a pastor, I think, sometimes, because even though that is a calling, it's not my identity. And I can't let my identity get wrapped up in the role or the job or the career or the calling or any of that. I have to get my identity from the right source. So another thing that we get really wrapped up in sometimes is what we have or what we don't have, and we can get our identity from that. You know as well as I do that social media is full of things that can become our identity or that we can grab onto. We've got influencers, you can't even think about something without seeing 40 ads pop up for you to buy that thing, right? But what we have or what we don't have is not our identity. Another thing that we fall into is what we think about ourselves. If we're not careful, that can become our identity. You know, we may look in the mirror sometimes and be like, man, I'm old, or I've got wrinkles, you know, I'm getting overweight, or I'm too short, or I'm too tall, or whatever the case may be. We can sometimes be our own worst critics, right? But those things are not our identity. What we think about ourselves is not our identity. All of these things that I've listed, they change, they shift, they're unstable, they're moving, they're fluid. And so those cannot be our identity, because who God created us to be does not change. Yes, there are different seasons in our lives when God may need to reveal a different aspect of our identity to us, depending upon the season of life that we're in. But he has known that identity from before the foundation of the world. And that gives us a lot of comfort when we can grasp that and know that. See, God created each one of us specifically and intentionally, and he wants us to know that more importantly than anything, he created us in his image. And we can read about that in Genesis 1:27. It's right there. He made us in his image. So if you and I are trying to get our identity from any other source but God, we're not going to wind up with anything other than a false identity. That's all that we can have outside of God. It's just something that we've conjured up ourselves. And false identities will always and only ever leave us feeling lost and empty and insecure and unstable. Until we actually receive our true identity from God, we will always be just trying to grasp onto anything and everything that feels like an identity or that feels like who we might be. As I was preparing this message, I kind of got this idea in my mind of an analogy that kind of really made sense to me. Imagine if you were walking along one day and you found a machine laying on the ground and you'd never seen anything like it before, and you didn't have any idea what it was or what it was for, what it did. So you pick it up and you're kind of looking at it, messing around. Well, then thankfully you see the person coming along to get it who made it. And you can ask them, hey, what is this machine? What was it made for? What does it do? That is what it's like with us. We have a source that we can get our true identity from, and it's the one who made us. The one who created us is the only one who can tell us what we were made for, because he's the one who made us. So we know what true identity does not come from, and we know that we have to go to the one who made us to get our identity. But one other thing that's really cool about us is we have something more. Imagine you were going to, you were talking to this person who made the machine, and they said, hey, by the way, I also have an instruction manual if you'd like to check that out that tells you more about this machine. Well, we even have that with God's Word, the Bible. It can tell us a lot about our identity, and God wants to reveal even more, but we can use his word to begin to build a foundation of who he says that we are. He wants us to discover our true identity, because he didn't just make cookie cutter people. He specifically dreamed up who you and I were going to be long before the foundation of the world. And as children of God, we have access to that true identity. The sad thing is that people don't, without becoming a child of God, people don't have access to their true identities. And so that they can just do the best that they can do. But you know what? The world needs who you and I were created to be. I want you to say that. The world needs who I was created to be. And maybe you need to write that on your mirror in the bathroom so that you can see it every morning, so that you can remember that it is true. No one was created on accident, so no one is exempt from that statement. God knew who you were going to be, and he, you know, regardless, I know sometimes we've heard people say, well, I was an accident. They used to say that about my little sister because she's 11 years younger than me, and they weren't necessarily planning to have kids. But guess what? God wasn't surprised. She was not an accident in God's eyes, because he knew before the foundation of the world. We don't have to look very hard around us in this world to see that there is desperation and confusion around identity. People want to know that. And the enemy wants to steal our identity. He wants to steal it because he doesn't want us to truly realize what God created us for. He doesn't want us to be able to fulfill the purposes and the dreams and the plans that God had in mind when he created each one of us. So he lies and he cheats and he steals. Nothing new. We're not going to focus on that. But there's an all-out attack from everything from gender confusion, sexuality confusion, mental illnesses, addictions, fill in the blank. The enemy is standing there, the enemy of our souls is handing out false identities left and right, because he wants us to never really truly realize who God created us to be, and to never fulfill the purposes that God put into us when he formed us in our mother's womb. So here's my definition. You can take it with a grain of salt. You can search it out more for yourself. But for me, this is what I believe true identity is. Our true identity is the core of who God made us to be. It is the truest version of ourselves, and it affects and influences everything in our lives. And knowing it brings us into alignment with our Creator. And it allows us to fulfill everything that he put into us. See, God didn't create any identities that are not like him. Remember we said a minute ago, he created man in his image, man and woman in his image. So there's no identities that are not like God that he created. So if we look at our lives and we evaluate what our lives look like, if we don't see God's image, if we see something other than that, then we can be pretty sure that we are living in a false identity. So some of you may be sitting here thinking, well, why are we even talking about identity at all? You know, let's just get on with things. Let's just do what the Bible says and not worry about it. Well, I believe that God is very clear in his word that he wants us to know who we are. If you look at the examples in the Bible of several people, there's so many stories, but Jacob, for one, God changed his name to Israel because he needed him to know the truth about who he had created him to be, and that he wanted him to be the father of this whole nation, the children of Israel. Abram, his name was changed to Abraham because, again, names have meaning. And his name as Abraham meant the father of many nations. His wife, Sarah, she used to be called Sarai. There's so many examples of God letting people know their names, who he says they are, their true identities. And the reason is because they need to know that, and we need to know that, to be able to carry out the plan and the purpose that he's put into us. See, we can only fully partner with him inside of our true identity. Without that, we'll be living in a false identity and we'll never be able to do all that he created us to do. So, like I said at the beginning, we're going to be focusing on our identity as a child of God today. And I think it's so foundational to know that we are a child of God. But I want to clear up some confusion that there is in the world, that everyone is a child of God. While everyone in this world, every human born on the planet is a creation of God, everyone is not automatically a child of God. Let me show you in John 1:12 how that lines up with Scripture. So it says this in John 1:12, "But to as many as did receive and welcome him, he gave the authority, power, privilege, right to become the children of God. That is, to those who believe in, adhere to, trust in, and rely on his name." And then another place in 1 John 5:1, it says, "Everyone who believes in, adheres to, trusts, and relies on the fact that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, is a born-again child of God. And everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of him, his offspring." So there's lots of scriptures. In fact, two more that you can go look up later if you have a minute that are really good is Galatians 3, 26 through 29, and then 1 John 3, 1 and 2. But we can see through these verses that there is a distinction between being a creation and becoming a child of God. And we need to know that because, like I said a minute ago, we can't fully receive our true identity if we do not become children of God and get access to that. And it's going to affect how we show up in our lives. If we are living in a false identity, then that's how we're going to show up in our lives. It's going to affect what we do, how we act, how we interact, all of these things. And I love how in 1 John 5:1 it says we are born again, born into God's family when we believe in Jesus and we accept him and put our faith in him. But what does this all mean for us, becoming a child of God? How does this affect our identity? How does this affect our lives? I'm going to look at three different areas today that I believe are so foundational, things that we need to understand as our identity as children of God. And those are that, number one, we're adopted. Number two, we're chosen. And number three, we're accepted. So as I was preparing for this message, I was just really praying. I was kind of hitting a block, and I was like, God, what do you want to say through this message? And I just felt so strongly. He was like, I want you to know my perspective, what my perspective is of my children. And as I was just kind of sitting there with Holy Spirit, I just was reminded of my grandson. For those of you who know, I became a grandma 15 months ago, and I have them, yeah. I really wanted to put a picture up, but I took all the self-control that I had to not. But Alistair is an amazing kid, and I have his picture. I have a deal on my phone where every time I open it, it shows a different picture of him. And if you ever see me just walking around looking at my phone and being stupid, then you know I'm looking at Alistair, because I just get giddy over him. He's so adorable, and you can just see his personality even through his expressions in a picture, you know. And I think I was just going, man, God, he's just so cute and so cool. And God was just like, yeah, I know. That's exactly how I feel about you. That's exactly how I feel about all of my kids. And then he reminded me of a time last year we were heading out to go visit our daughter and son-in-law and our grandson. And then we were going to go on from there and visit our son and his girlfriend. And we had a lot of drive time. So we were listening to music, and we were, for a while, we were listening to some music that our son had written and recorded, and I was just blown away. I was just thinking about my kids. I was like, God, my kids are amazing. I don't know if you guys do this. Maybe I'm weird. But I was like, God, these kids are so cool. They're so loving. They're caring people. They're smart. They're creative. They're just amazing. And I was just blown away. I was like, God, how did we get so lucky to be their parents? They're just really, really awesome. And he hit me so hard in that moment. I started crying because he was like, I know. That's exactly how I feel about you. That's exactly what I think when I look at all of my kids. He loves us, you guys. He loves us so much more than we can even imagine. And that's not based on anything but who we are. He loves us because he created us. He wants every single one to be his child. But like I said, we have free will and we have that choice. But his offer is out there for everyone. And his offer is, number one, to adopt us. He wants us to be adopted into his family. And if you have made that choice and you are a child of God, you need to know that you are adopted. Ephesians 2:2-3 says, and you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. It was not good, guys. We were orphans. Turn to your neighbor and say, I was an orphan. But now turn back to him and say, but God. Amen. Because that verse, that passage goes on and it says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I encourage you to go read the rest of that chapter 2 of Ephesians later today if you have time, because it is so, so good. Another place where we read about his adoption is in Romans 8:14-16. And it just says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Amen. That is great news. We are children of God. We are adopted into his family. He has called us son, and he has called us daughter. And he didn't have a selfish motive in this. He had such an unselfish motive to want to adopt us. Back in the day when this was written, being an orphan was a really horrible situation, because we didn't have foster homes. We didn't have ways to help orphans back in the day. And so you might be adopted if you were a male and they wanted to carry on their family name, or you might get adopted if you could work and clean and be a servant or a slave. But he's not offering that. He's saying, I want to be your Abba. I want to be that father, and I want to bless you. I want to have an intimate and close relationship with you. And so when we understand that, it changes how we live our lives. It changes how we react when things happen. We don't have to freak out every time something happens. We don't have to walk around stressed and anxious because we know that we have a Father who is looking out for us. We have our Abba. And He wants that. He wants that close, intimate relationship that when things fall apart, and they're going to fall apart at times. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. So things are going to happen, but He's always going to be there. And He wants us to rely on Him and to trust in Him. I think probably the biggest tragedy of all would be to not accept His offer of adoption. But I think a close second would be what a lot of people do, honestly, is they accept the offer of adoption, but then they don't really believe it. They don't maybe truly understand it, and so they just continue to live like orphans, not really believing that they have a good Father that's there for them. But part of His adoption is that He also made us heirs. His adoption has made us heirs, and it's so important that we know that, because it's got, let me tell you, more good news. Romans 8, 16 through 17 says, "The Spirit Himself thus testifies together with our own spirit, assuring us that we are children of God. And if we are His children, then we are His heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, sharing His inheritance with Him. Only we must share His suffering if we are to share His glory." But look at that. It says we are fellow heirs with Christ. As adopted children, that means that we have access to everything that Jesus has access to. Think about that. I wonder how that would change our lives and our world if we all really knew that and believed that, that we have access to everything that Jesus has access to. It's kind of a funny story, but you know, how many of you have ever heard of refrigerator rights? So how many of you as adult children, when you go to visit your parents, you just walk right in and open the refrigerator and see what there is to eat? Anybody else, or is it just me? You have refrigerator rights. Now, if I went into your house and I went in and just went and opened the refrigerator, you would probably think something was wrong with me, right? You would be, you're a little rude. But I go to my parents, I go and, you know what, I ask. As I'm taking the cookie out of the bag and putting it in my mouth, I'm like, is it okay if I have one of these? And of course they're like, well, yeah, sure. But we have refrigerator rights. As children of God, as adopted children, we have access to the Father, to the throne room, to every single thing that Jesus has access to. So how does this show up in my life? What does this look like? It means I don't have to compare myself. I don't have to compete with anyone else because I have my own place with my own Father, my own Abba. So I don't have to worry about if you get blessed because He's not going to take away my stuff to give it to you. He's got plenty for all of us. He has enough of every single thing that we need. And in this, because of this, I can be genuinely happy for you when you're blessed because I know that I'm going to be well taken care of too. I can let all of my insecurities fall away because I know that I'm held and that I am loved by my Father and that I am secure in His love. And I also don't have to defend myself anymore because He's my defender. He's my protector, He's my provider, He's my Abba. The second area that we're going to look at is that we are chosen. We are chosen, and we need to know this. It's a big deal to know that we're chosen. Now, I realized as I was doing this message that I may have had some trauma from PE in grade school because as I was preparing this message, I was like, I think I had a story from PE in grade school in my last message. So, but just so that you know, I'm good. I've been healed from the trauma of grade school PE class. Thank God we have Sozo Ministry here, so I've gone through that. But no, I remembered being in grade school and when we would play kickball, and they would line us all up, and they would pick two team captains, and then they would start picking. I want you. I want you. I want you. And I just remember sitting there going, oh, dear Jesus, please do not let me be the last one picked. Because that was the dreaded thing, right? That was the worst thing ever if you were the last one picked. You just did not want to be the last one picked. But this is not the case with God. He chose us. He chose each and every one of us to be part of his team, to be part of his family. John 15:16, I love how it says it. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit and that your fruit should abide so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. And then Ephesians 1:3-5 says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. I love how it says that. Even in him, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. So think about that. Before he ever even spoke one single thing into existence, he was thinking about you. He was thinking about me. And he knew that he wanted us to be part of his team. That's why he made the sacrifice that he made. And he made it for everyone. And he offers it to everyone. So what does this mean for my life? Knowing that part of my identity is that I am a chosen child of God. This helps me to know that I have worth. I don't have to question my worth anymore. I'm not standing there in the kickball line anymore wondering if I'm going to get picked. I don't have to wonder if I'm good enough. I don't have to wonder if anyone else sees value in me because I know that my Father does. I know that he sees value and worth in me because he paid the highest price possible for me so that I could choose, that I could be a child of God. And he said that I was worth it, and he said that you were worth it too. The last area that we're going to look at as far as our identity as a child of God is concerned is that we are accepted. We are accepted. Guess what? You and I have a place at the table. Have you ever been to a dinner party, a fancy dinner party, where they have place cards and your name's on one of them and you have a place at the table? I don't think I've ever been to one, but I've seen it on TV. But I would love to do that sometime. But think about it. You have a place at the table, and everyone he ever created, he set a place for them. And sadly, not everyone will come and take their place at the table. But we have a place at the table, which is huge to know because that means we were accepted before we ever did anything. Think about that. Just becoming a child of God made us accepted. And it says it really plainly in Ephesians 1:6, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved. He made us accepted in the beloved. The beloved is Jesus Christ, and he put us into Christ. It wasn't anything that we did. We just received his offer, right? We just accepted his offer to become part of his family. You know, I was thinking about my grandson like I do a lot, and I was like, you know what, how ridiculous would it be if I said, yeah, you know, he's really cute and so sweet and I love him, but I'm really going to just have to wait till he grows up a little bit and see what he does for me before I can decide if I'm going to accept him as my grandson. I mean, how crazy is that? There's no way you would be like, go away. Something's wrong with you. It's not how God is. He's not expecting us to earn acceptance. He wants us to know that we're accepted because then it will change how we live our life. If we fall into the lie of the enemy that tells us that we have to just work harder or try harder or be good enough on our own, that's going to get us nowhere. The enemy loves to do that. He loves to lie to us and say, hey, you know what? You've got to earn God's acceptance. You're not doing enough. You're not good enough. You got to try harder and do better. And then guess what? He's the one that's the first one going to be there saying, yeah, see, I told you you couldn't do it. I knew you were going to fail. Because guess what? We can't do it in our own strength. And we definitely can't do it if we don't believe that it's true, that we are accepted, that that's part of our identity. There is definitely a place where our behavior and our actions demonstrate the truth about who we are, what we know to be true as our standing as a child of God. That is absolutely true. Our behavior and actions demonstrate that. But a lot of times we get the cart before the horse. And like I said, we fall into that lie that the enemy's throwing out there. It makes me think of Galatians 3:1-3. It says, O foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? It was before your eyes that Jesus Christ was publicly portrayed as crucified. So let me ask you only this. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by hearing with faith? Are you so foolish, having begun by the Spirit, are you now being perfected by the flesh? I don't know, maybe I'm silly, maybe I'm naive, but I have this crazy belief that what we believe matters. That if we don't believe correctly about who we are, that we will never, our behavior will never be what it's supposed to be and what it can be. Think about this. Okay, how many of you guys have ever gotten caught in an endless reel loop? Okay, I'm the only one. Sorry, y'all go. No, I was looking at reels one day and I came across this reel where these people were going across a glass bridge, and it was beautiful, and but there was this really deep gorge, you know, below the bridge. And so there was a little toddler, he's standing there with his sippy cup and he's looking at that glass bridge, and his family's going across it, and he's like, no, no way. I'm not stepping on that. He has no confidence or belief that that bridge is going to keep him safe, that it's going to keep him from falling a really long ways. And so he does try. He turns around backwards and puts one foot out and then the other foot out. And then he stands up and looks around and he's like, nope. And he goes right back onto the solid ground. He doesn't believe that that's going to keep him safe. So that determined what his behavior was. Our belief and our understanding of the truth of our identity in Christ determines how and what we will do. If we know that we are accepted, we're not going to feel like we have to prove anything anymore. We're not going to feel like we have to judge other people in order to try and feel better about ourselves. We're not going to have to compare ourselves to others. We're going to be able, when we know that we are accepted, we're able to accept other people. We're able to walk in grace and love. We're able to have confidence. We're able to love God and receive His love. And we're able to love other people without fear of rejection. We're able to champion others in their true identity. I don't know about you, but that sounds like a pretty great way to live to me. In closing, going back to where we started with this machine analogy, you had to get with the person who created the machine, right? We have to get with the one who created us. That's the only place that we're going to find our true identity and know what it means to be His child and know what it means to be adopted, to be chosen, and to be accepted. My prayer for everyone in this place is that we would all know that. That we would all know that in His presence is the only place where we can find and fully receive the truth of who we are. He wants each one of us to be able to live that life and to fulfill the purposes. There's nothing more that brings more joy than knowing that you're fulfilling the purpose of what God created you for. And it's not hard. It's not mysterious. It's not complicated. It's so simple. It's just going to the one who made you and asking him. If you would, just go ahead and close your eyes for a minute. Some of you today have never had the chance to, or never maybe even taken the chance to accept this offer that he is giving out to you to be adopted, to become a child of God. And maybe today the Holy Spirit's just tugging on your heart and you know that today is your day to say yes and to just come into his family, become a part of his family, become his child, receive his offer of adoption. Know what it feels like to be chosen and accepted. If that's you today, I want to ask you to raise your hand. And I'm not going to single you out. I'm not going to call you forward or do anything to draw attention to you. I just want to know who I'm going to be praying with. So if that's you, raise your hand real quickly. He's a good father. He's safe. And he wants to be there for you. Thank you. Yes, I see your hand. Thank you. Yes. Yes. Thank you. Yes. So many times, there's a lot of us who have accepted the offer of adoption at one point or another, but we've either really didn't truly believe it or didn't truly understand it, didn't know that we were chosen, that we were accepted, that we were adopted. And maybe you look in the mirror sometimes and you just feel like, who is this person? And you know that you're living in a false identity at this point in your life. If that's you, I want to invite you to raise your hand. We're going to pray about both of these things here in just a second. But just acknowledge that, yes, I do. Yes, thank you. That you want to know your true identity in Christ. Because he wants you to know it more than you want to know it. Go ahead and let's all stand up together. We're going to pray. And I just want to ask you to repeat after me and join everyone join together in this prayer. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross. Thank you for taking my sin upon yourself. And Father God, thank you for allowing me to become a child of God. I admit today that I need a Savior. And I believe, Jesus, that you are that Savior. And I choose today to commit my life to you, to walk with you, to talk with you, and to receive my true identity from you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you raised your hand today, I just want to encourage you that at the close of service, we're going to be in the prayer room. We would love to get to meet you, get to celebrate with you, and we have some things that we want to get in your hands to help you get connected. We love you. Let's worship God.
You unravel me with melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood has washed me clean. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Yes, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Child of God, you split the sea. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and say, I am a child of God. I am a child of God. Yes, I am a child of God.
Give him a shout of praise. We are so grateful that you are here with us today. And what are we going to do, church? We're going to go out there and...
I couldn't come all the way from England without bringing this flag. I want to read something from Isaiah 61, is that okay? This is fun, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, here it comes the joy. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me. For he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. And there is freedom, freedom for the captives. Oh, that's why we need the joy. And there's a crown of beauty instead of the ashes, instead of sadness, there's a garment of praise. We'll be right back.
us from the dust. And since our existence, there's only been one mission: for you to commune with us. And then came the garden, we became the fallen. Sin made us lose our way. Oh, but the love that's too good to give up set a course for amazing grace. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Tell everybody how he saved you. This is the gospel.
greatest miracle of all time. You got power, demons cower when they hear your name call. You got power, the steel towers make a lion look small. You got power to devour any counterfeit roar. Even your tongue is a sword, gallop the score. You are the Lord. Holy. 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 All those funerals you're rolling when you made the dead rise. Heaven's healer, use a spit and mud to open blind eyes. You got wonders I can know but couldn't count if I tried. Called the doctor and the doctor said I'm giving you life. Tell your enemies the victory is already here. More than 60,000 angels to the tip of the spear. One day every knee will bow and every heart will be healed. This is the end of a war, count up this war.
Lost but now I'm found.